Hi everyone, I'm Santosh. I'm coming from Hyderabad basically for this session. Before even jumping on to this one, I'm sure you might be engaging with a couple of analytics, machine learning, deep learning, training data, etc. from the last couple of days, or rather even in your experience. I want to give you altogether a different perspective of what is analytics. See, my view of analytics or artificial intelligence or machine learning, it's another revolution that would happen in the next 10 to 12 years. But prior to that, what has happened? Isn't that there is no analytics prior to that? That is an industrial evolution, right? Basically, a person who is writing a ledger has transformed it into a digital way, largely using Excel. So, and earlier there were devices, analytical devices. But through this session, I want to share you something. A spreadsheet can become intelligent. What does it mean? That is what the next generation we are trying to do. How can I make a table intelligent? How can I make a light intelligent? Nothing but, rather than just they acting as a dumb devices, can they give some insights about themselves or surrounding it? So, I'm currently a student from ISB. Currently a student, I'm a current student from ISB and currently working with Signity as a business process consultant. So largely focusing on the operational analytics. So near future, I'll be converting into a business analytics. So through this session, I have two objectives, which would be key takeaways for you guys. First, improving reporting the past. So can somebody tell me, what do you mean by reporting the past? Analyzing historical data. Analyzing is the second part. So I'm just talking about the reporting part. So how do we report the historical data? We all know, right, a visual is 1,000 times or million times better than the data. So I will give you altogether a different perspective of talking about the historical data, not just charts, not just tables. And the next objective is enabling predicting the future. I'm taking one step to make Excel intelligent. Excel, here I am using it as a spreadsheet, which is applicable to any spreadsheets. So let's go one by one. So quick questions. How many of us have Excel on our laptops and desktops? Almost everybody. And most of the times, you may ask me, why do we need to choose even Excel when there is R, Python, a lot of things are there, right? So how many of you here are more or less 7 to 8 years work experience in IT industry? Most of them. But so when the experience grows, and I'm talking only about IT guys, but there are some, for example, my dad is working in a business from the last 20 years, 30 years. Does it mean that he's not taking any decisions? Yes, he's taking decisions. Coding should not be a battle thing for him to take certain decisions. So how many of us open Excel at least once in a day? Almost everybody. So rather I want to put it as in an hour. And the next one, how many of us contribute or collect the data? Either I will give the data to my manager or some superior or some business. Our business will collect the data. So everybody is playing around the data. That is what the entire thing about. And next, can we eliminate Excel or replace with some other softwares in the era of big data or programming? Any thoughts? Yes, how many? Can we eliminate Excel in the next 10 years? No. So we have to continue using Excel. So what can we do? So can we eliminate mobile phone in the next 10 years? No. So what can we do beyond the current usage of things? I have to make mobile intelligent. I have to make spectacles intelligent. I have to make even software intelligent. One of that step is Excel. The last point which I want to share is, can we extend the capabilities of Excel from business intelligence, which is nothing but reporting the past, to machine learning and enable artificial intelligence? So that is where I want to heading to. So I'm sure you might have seen this slide. You can just run through. So this is a slide which one of our professors shared to us. So reporting the past is nothing but business intelligence. Predicting the future is nothing but machine learning. Taking one decision, I repeat, taking one decision from the machine learning means, for example, I tell you that from the last 3-4 days, I collect the data of feedback from individuals. That is reporting the past. So what do I need to predict? Tomorrow one more person enters, I can predict what could be his feedback. And what do I need to do with that? I can take one action on that. That is data science. Then what is artificial intelligence, which is the heading of overall conference and a lot of things? Artificial intelligence is taking the best out of multiple decisions. That's what learning the rules and taking one step, one best step among the rules. So far, if you see, the spreadsheets are working on this area only. So my intent is to take it to the next level. Give a little insight on how can we take it to this level. Let's go ahead. Yeah, and then further and further. Short term and in the long term, that can happen. So it's only computational challenge which you will have. And the key phases of analytics, I just want to run through quickly a couple of slides. I'll handle. So key phases in analytics, basically goal setting, data extraction, data exploration, could be visualization, whatever it could be, data analysis and modeling. So without any of these things, I'm sure we are working more on this one. I'm sure every one of us has done at least one or two graphs in our entire experience. So we are largely dependent on somebody has given the data and I am exploring it and do some analysis. Maximum analysis which we will do is inference out of the charts. So I'll take a little bit beyond that. So my focus for this session is third phase and the last phase. So past is nothing but entire top row is past and future is the next thing. So there are couple, and here onward we'll see couple of spreadsheets which will be working like what you call it as edit distance or etc. So let me share you one important so as you can see here, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 phases. So at every phase, how Excel will be made intelligent is what I'll explain you quickly. And here I want to show you some important visualization. Before that, see, this is a video which is generated out of Excel. And the data is across the globe, earthquakes, nuclear explosions, all those things. So this is, we can think of this as an another way of exploring, showing the data without using Tableau or Python or whatever it could be. I'll show you another type of visualization as well. How many have you heard about the name called Hans Rosling? Hans Rosling, heard about it, right? There are a couple of TED videos on him who actually presents data in a time series. For example, imagine if there is a time series, what do you think is the best chart to represent? Line chart. On the x-axis, you will have time and y-axis, you will have the data. But he tries to explain time chart as a cross-sectional. Now, if you see the screen, it is 2014. Next, 2015. It is an animation kind of thing. So let me show you that in Excel again. See, this is the, I'm not sure if you are able to see the x-axis, no, right? Okay, x-axis is the fertility rate and y-axis is the life expectancy. And each circle represents one country and the size of the circle is nothing but the population. You might have seen this data set. But if you see, in the general terms, we cannot take 1, 2, 3 in a particular snapshot. But if I have another dimension, I have no option that I have to take another filter. So now if you can think about it like this, this is another way we can think of adding another dimension. So now it will, for every section, it will try to show for the individual as if there is an animation going on. So adding more dimensions can, using VBA, we can add more dimensions. We can think in that direction. That's what I guess most of you are familiar with Tableau. We have a playback in Tableau. So that kind of thing. And this is about the visualization part which I want to share. And how many of you heard about something called as Levenstein edit distance? What do you think is great? So for example, may I know your name, sir? Arun. So what is the distance between Santosh name and Arun name as a keyword? What is the distance between Santosh and maybe some other, Ram Charan? some different. So how do we calculate? So this guy has developed a methodology to calculate the distance between two different keywords based on replacement, deletion, or updation. So what I try to do is I try to just include that as part of spreadsheet, as part of my exercise. So there is an input called mushroom, and I have multiple options. So maybe I'll put something as Bangalore. So once you click on suggest, it will tell me which is it. There is a tie here. So it tells two of the things are having equal rating, here and here. Maybe I'll give her some other name. Arun. So in the behind the scenes, I'm not doing anything else but running this algorithm, which is nothing but the concept which he has written, like it should start from left, compare each two characters, and through some navigation, we can get to the score of the score between any two words. And I'm trying to take this one to the next level by comparing two different strings, not two words, but two different strings. So that can also be done in terms of similarity distance. So one very important point which I just thought to share you is, see, machine learning, prediction, classification, everything is nothing but an optimization problem, which has an objective, whether I want to increase the variance, reduce the variance, increase the mean, reduce the mean, or whatever, increase the accuracy by controlling some parameters. Could be hyperparameter, could be complexity parameter, whatever it could be. And I have my own constraints. So in that way, if I want to just compare two different strings, here there are two strings. There is nothing in this room I need to eat. Nothing is the first thing in this room. So through this quick, small, I mean, I'm not saying this is an NLP level of thing, but as a basic level, an individual can just create these sort of things to understand the initial analytics of the data. He need not, I'm not telling that we should not think about NLP. That is a long term. For a person, see, we are trying to understand a lot of things in this conference. But once we are at our own desktops, again, the first thing which we see is a spreadsheet, isn't it? So there where I'm coming from. So if you see, there is a similarity of 27% between these two strings based on the words. So that is again calculated based on how many are, there is a kind of a lift, kind of how many are common, as simple as set A, set B, which are intersection divided by the union, as simple as that. So these are some small things which you can think of doing in spreadsheet. So largely I'm talking about, there is also some methodology where you can do a web scraping in Excel. So I don't want to get into that now. Data visualization, I've shown you a video and this one. And there is some important thing which I want to share here. Dynamic charts. So what comes to your mind when you think of a dynamic chart? Sir, can you just let me know? What comes to your mind when you think of a dynamic chart? Yeah. No, there's an English meaning of dynamic. Something that is continuously changing. Nothing but agile kind of. So for example, here, if the same data set again, here, I can change this. This gets changed. I can change this. I can change this. That level is nothing but from the basic Excel chart to, I can take to dynamic chart. But I want to show you something different here.
Hello all, good evening. Welcome to month-wise earthquake. Mean no of earthquake is 1935.75. Maximum in
March.
Minimum in
June.
Good day.
So some basic inferences can be done by us, because when we dig into analytics, we'll be lost of basic stuff. So some basic things which we put rules, for example, currently, whatever charts, whatever things we do, the exploratory data analysis should be done by human. So when we put these basic rules in the program itself, the inference can be done by machine. So that is what my thought. And last, most important thing which I want to share you is a couple of things which I have done as part of predicting the future. So far you were talking about earthquake data, all those things are past data. There's nothing to do with the prediction. But these are all market basket analysis, co-occurrence analysis, all those things are nothing but, as you see, as a packages in Python or R. So let me quickly show you neural networks, and then if time permits, I'll open the other files. So I hope, or more or less, I don't want to repeat again, more or less, largely everybody know about MNIST data, right? We have a 28 by 28 matrix for every digit, and we want to predict whether it is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever it could be. Now again, just a quick insight, what is neural network? You might be aware about it. So neural network is, I recollect my professor's statement. There are three different kinds of people in analytics. One person who is deadly statistical in nature. Other person who is probabilistic in nature. And the third guy is who is network-oriented guy. So any algorithm which you think of, either it could be one among these three only. So the third part category comes into the picture when it is neural network. And similarly, we can have, that is the reason we use MNIST data set in all the three categories. Through linear regression, logistic regression, and the second one would be probability by Bayesian null classifiers or the last thing, neural networks. So I quickly explain this with you, this to you, how we try to do this. And I'm inspired by one guy who has actually shown how to create this in YouTube, but I try to take the technicalities, but not the approach, because I'm aware about the approach. So here, as I say, here the data set is hardly 90 or 95, mixture of zeros, nines, ones, and etc. And the processing here is, see here, I just converted the pixel to a number between 0, minus 1 and 1 using a sigmoid function. And these are my only one intermediate layer having 20 nodes. And these 20 nodes feeds in final data to the last 10 digits, because I may have 0, 1, etc, etc. So the probability here explains me what kind of a digit it is. So basically 784 columns reduced to 20 different nodes, neurons, and then 10. So now I'll show you exactly how exactly machine learns. So for example, there are around 107 data points. I take a random data point, maybe 39. It has given 5, right? There are two things which I have done in the background. The back propagation of neural networks, I have put it in a VBA program. Whenever I run that, once, twice, thrice, four times, based on that, it will, so if I just put click on Control L, I'll just count it, Control 1. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it's not working. So after some time, it could able to detect. Now if I put a different number, it will not take this much time, it will take less time. You can observe that. So sorry, this has taken more time. See here, the point, it's not about the time again. The point here, what I meant is, I want to show you how learning happens. At the start, during the progress of the time, it will definitely find what it is. That is what I mean. So after taking multiple, when I put this again in loop, after taking multiple points, then I can stop it there and put a testing data set here. The main reason why I have shown this one to you is, we can perform a basic machine learning algorithms in Excel. It could be a neural networks, it could be a k-means clustering, etc, etc. And there is one thing which I want to share here, the last one, co-occurrence analysis, which is very important thing, I feel. And then I will summarize. So imagine these 10 are neurons. So there's an experiment which was done. 10, rats have been given some different kinds of ingestions, and they try to observe how they react, which two neurons react together. For example, let's say it's very hot. What are the two neurons of a human will trigger more as compared to all hundreds and thousands of neurons? So there where I try to put the random numbers. So if you see here, this is nothing but each interval. For first interval, these neurons are hitting together. In this interval, these neurons are hitting together. So using a concept called lift, which are coming together as compared to individual, I try to create some So when I just do something like this, so those are random numbers. See here. So whenever I refresh, a new data set comes into the picture. And if you see here, these two neurons are at the top. These two are hitting together as compared to this one. So I can focus on these two neurons and get to the feature extraction. Okay, these two neurons are coming in together. Why don't I take these two as my features in that direction? Okay. And can I take a minute to show market basket analysis? So again, there is positives and negative sides to every algorithm. So basically, market basket analysis, as most of you know, is just quick summary, which two products are bought together. So the biggest challenge here is, as a person, if I'm going to a market or a e-commerce, I may buy a laptop, I may buy a chocolate. So it doesn't mean that, so I have a context in mind. So I need to bring out that context. So here the intent is not to that level, but to just validate which two products are bought together. So imagine this is an invoice or a couple of bills, and where he bought ABCD, some different products. So there is a little overlap as well. So let me just run this and show it to you. So I take this particular data, around 12 points, and tell that this is my data set. And just it tells, see, I forgot very important thing. As a person who is analyzing the market basket, market data, I need to tell the very critical parameter, which is called threshold. Threshold is the hyper parameter in market basket analysis. If at all the score of the two different products is less than this, I don't want to take it to the next level. So that goes into a different topic, but I don't want to get into that. If you see here, when I take a single product at a time, the score of all these things, when F has been bought more, none of these are bought less than 3 times. So therefore, everything is good to go to the next level. One ho gaya, go to the 2. Make sense? When it is 2, again go to the 3. And when it goes to 2, AB is 3, AD is 3, and EF is 6, FG is 6. But all other things are less than 0. Means these can go to the next set again. I need to compare these 3. Take, for example, ABD. I can validate. ADF, something like this. So then I can gradually accumulate which all the things are getting contribution more. Makes sense, right? So let me summarize the last. So this I have shown to you. So this is what we can even think of, like exploratory data analysis definitely takes enough amount of time, isn't it? So there should be a mechanism even to not to automate, but even to define the rules over there. So that, because as a data scientist, when we dig into the data analytics part, we will forget the basics of it. So when we put rules on it, it will automatically evaluate. If Excel can do all these things, I have not written the list, just want to hear from you guys. One example which I want to share you is, how many of you have you used sum function, if function in Excel? Great. Tomorrow I want to use similarity function in Excel. Tomorrow I want to use k-means, open the bracket, give the range, there should be a model coming out. You are understanding where I am coming from, right? So that is what the vision which I have to do for Excel. And the goal is analytics for a common businessman. It's not you, me, it's a business, my dad or somebody who is just running a cab or somebody, an individual business owner. The last but not the least, tougher the problem, higher the usage of processes, brain. The higher the complicated problem we solve, the more we try to do. And these are all lists which I thought I would share with you, like starting with learning the basics concepts and then extending to these things. So that is it which I want to share. And a lot of things I have, I'll try to share it in some other placeholder. Yeah, that's what. So I'll share a couple of files which I have. And yeah, the last important thing, any questions?
So all these are a part of the DB script written as a part of the macro?
some things require VBA script, some things doesn't. For example, I will show you one dashboard. Exactly, that is what they are. That is what they are trying to do. In the other way, yeah, please go ahead.
No, that's what I'm asking.
Yes.
Is this all VBA script?
Yes. Yes.
Which of these are not?
VBA. For let me tell you like this. Heard about macros, right?
Yeah.
So, for example, can I, if anything that, which one, I mean, what all the, when we think of automating something, what is the first thing which should be taken care of?
The metadata. Like, say, if I want to take similarity between two sheets, I will compare the metadata.
Should that be, I'm talking about an activity. An activity should be automated. What is the most important thing about the activity you should think of? 100%. So macros is something which will be repeated. Dashboards, will you repeat it? No. So what will you repeat? Learning of the algorithm. Because the more I repeat it, the more I learn. So in that direction, macros will be implemented. Along with that, if we use optimized formulas embedded in Excel, like sentiment, open the bracket, take some text, and it should give the score. And the extent which I'm thinking of is, I will use my cursor and select this. It should give the sentiment score of tougher. In the context of this presentation, it can be done. I'm not telling it cannot be done. It can be done. I'm not a programmer at all. I'm not at all a programmer. I'm hardcore business consultant. I try to understand the business process, record the macro for the first time, understand the code, change the constant to variables. Some places I use, not all the slides, wherever there are static things, whenever I click the button, right, that is the VBA. And you don't believe me, the one which I just clicked on the to speak, right, just three lines. And even I'm not, I just try. VBA, just it's like as good as downloading some package. But the point where I'm coming from is, Joy told me earlier, when we run algorithms using R, Python, we depend on the packages code written by somebody. And I take decisions, business decisions based on the guy who has written for the... So we have to create our own algorithm. That can be done. I'm not telling which cannot be done in R and Python, but that is one way we can learn. Second thing is your decisions will be in your control, not in the control. Tomorrow that guy will tell I did some mistake. Who will be at loss? Again, that doesn't happen, but I'm just telling you. Any questions? Yeah, that's what, right? When I, actually the problem got solved in the morning, so I did not put the button over there. I just did Control L, that's all. Yeah, it's VBA. Yeah, I tried to type in that. No, 90% of that one neural network is not using VBA. It is just, I don't want to say it as VBA at all. It is just a mathematics. In the neural, you mean? In neural network? No, that is just to have one at a time. I have 20 data points, 20 data rows. Send me one at a time so that I will learn. But again, I repeat, in that neural network, I have not used macros. Yeah. Thank you so much.